You walk into this room at your own risk, because it leads to the future. Not a future that will be, but one that might be. This is not a new world. It is simply an extension of what began in the old one. It has patterned itself after every dictator who has ever planted the ripping imprint of a boot on the pages of history since the beginning of time. It has refinements, technological advances, and a more sophisticated approach to the destruction of human freedom. But like every one of the superstates that preceded it, it has one iron rule. Logic is an enemy and truth is a menace.
Hi, I'm Chaotic Good, and welcome to Episode 5, Citizen Journalism. The last time we saw each other, I warned everyone to get ready for a banking crisis, and now here we are. If you haven't watched Episode 4, I made us a how-to video on how to handle it, so you don't panic. It's still available on my channel if you haven't watched it yet, or you're a new follower. So most of the time, you guys see me covering financial news, but in the past week, I shared a video of Jose Vega, speaking out at a Columbia School of Journalism free speech event, and it went viral. I got so many shares and comments, and so many people wanted to know who this guy was. So I tracked down Jose this week to talk to him a little bit more about what he does. Normally I don't do interview formats. This is the first time, so I'm pretty excited. I hope you guys really like the interview. Don't forget to click the button below to subscribe to my channel. That way you get a notification every time I post a new video.
So the last thing you could do to try and actually fix your reputation is acknowledge that through leaks, we had to find out that Zelensky was going to bomb Moscow on the anniversary. Cowards, every single one of you. None of you have actually had any relevancy. And you know what? The mainstream press is now dying. Nobody's ever going to listen to you again. You have no credibility with the public. The only people who care about what you have to say are elite assholes who have nothing productive to say anymore. And it's dying off.
There we go. Someone started recording.
We've got it. Oh, this is so exciting. Okay, great. So I'm not a big time media player. I've got a lot of people that have been following me over the last few years. I feel like since I've gotten really into a passion project situation with independent, like, citizen journalism, since the GameStop situation kind of broke out. Meme stocks have been my jelly for the last couple of years. So I found your video, or the video of you kind of crashing Columbia School of Journalism's free speech event, you know, because we watched you get dragged out of a free speech event, which is crazy in 2023. And so I posted this on my channel, and I've got a not a huge following, but like this got a lot of, I think, 1.5 million views the last time I looked, which is a lot for me.
Well, just, well, 1.5 million views on my Twitter, and then you have to count, like, the bootlegs, as my friend likes to call it. Basically, people who download the video and then repost it on their Twitter, and they're like, who is this guy?
You know? Yeah, that's basically, like, I saw it, I feel like, through maybe the redheaded libertarian. She had shared it, and I picked it, and all of a sudden, it was just everywhere. But that was the big question. Everyone was like, who is this guy? Like, at first, I didn't even know. And so, like, everybody is constantly, just because I cover all the GameStop Wall Street corruption in the media, I do a lot of financial journalism, covering like cryptocurrency, covering like precious metals, covering the stock market, things going on with Wall Street and the Federal Reserve. I'm a big like libertarian issue type. You know, I don't necessarily follow one particular party or the other. So a lot of people are drawn to my posts because it is more independent. And I feel like that's what everybody needs after the last few years. I feel like in the last 3 years, especially, corporate media has just completely shut out anything outside of, we've chosen a narrative. This is what we're going with. If you dissent from this in any way, we're going to figure out a way to deplatform you. We're going to try to keep you quiet. We're going to ban you from X, Y, or Z. I mean, they hold you out for, you know, making very, very valid points. But everybody just kind of, I feel like we want to know more about you and more about what you're doing and what happened.
Well, born and raised in the Bronx. My political journey started when I was like 14 or 15 years old. And in Manhattan, I was walking by the LaRouche tables and they had this poster of Obama with a Hitler stash. Some people might remember that, some may not. It's super controversial. And that was basically it. I remember I would yell at their tables as I would walk by and say, oh, whatever the hell. And occasionally I would stop because they were in Manhattan. I went to school in Manhattan. And so, you know, every day walking back home from school, I'd see them. And sometimes I'd stop and just challenge them. And I decided to come to their meeting one day. And then there I was, you know. And I realized I really didn't know what I was talking about. I was just driven more by, like, emotion, you know, and thinking I knew what I was saying, but I really didn't. And so, that's kind of what started it at that point, if you're interested in my background. And then I studied a lot of classical art, music, science, and poetry. So that's me. That's who I am. Now, in terms of, like, this event and the intervention, this is just one in many. I don't know if you saw one that went viral back in October where
everybody's been sending me so many links. It's not the first time you've done this. So I'm just really impressed that I feel like we're lacking a passion when it comes to the media. We've gotten, when it comes to corporate media, when you turn on the TV or you try to read, you know, a lot of what's on social media, it's really almost TMZ-like, where everything is, you know, if it bleeds, it leads. We're on a 24/7 news cycle. Everything has to be very fantastical. Everything has to be very exaggerated. And there's little to no responsibility for being correct. I mean, if somebody runs a follow-up with corrections, it's never as big of a situation as it was when we first broke the story, you know. And there's just no accountability for the most part for being wrong. And after the pandemic, people have sort of hit their breaking point with the tolerance for it. So when we see somebody screaming at the New York Times in person, and, you know, you're saying what a lot of us have been thinking, but haven't had the opportunity to scream at an editor for the New York Times. But, you know, everybody is, there's so much support for this that when everybody started filling up the comment section with questions, I'm like, you know what, you guys, let's take it right to the source. Let's go find him. Let's figure out what's going on. So how did you end up at this one particular event for Columbia?
It was an event that was open to the public, which is a point I want to make. It was open to the public, free to register. You just go on Eventbrite. It was there. It was advertised to hell and back. And, you know, those are corporate bigwigs, right? The executive editor of the New York Times, LA Times, Washington Post, Reuters, Jonathan Capehart of MSNBC. You're telling me only like 60, 70 people show up to this thing? I mean, they filled up the room, but, like, did they not expect more people to come? Like, and it wasn't even just that panel only, because Masha Gessen from The New Yorker, you know, was there too, right? Like, and the other thing is, like, the median age in that room was, like, people who were over 65 or something, you know, like.
I think if people were more aware, we would probably have more, you know, the majority of the people that comment on my material are, you know, I've got a pretty wide age range in my following, but it's going to be mostly people under the age of 45, I feel like, 45 or 50.
Right, and that's a good, you know, that speaks to my point, right? Nobody cares what the legacy media has to say anymore, right? Nobody
ever. When was the last time they've been right? I feel like they've been so hardcore wrong over the last, like, 3 years especially. They've been wrong about things like the pandemic. They've been really wrong about things in the financial world, things that affect the way that we function on a day-to-day basis. You know, I called the banking collapse 6 months before it happened and told everybody to start getting ready. I posted a how-to video on how to get ready for it, and then it happened and people kind of lost their mind. I'm like, you guys, there's this information's out there. We just need to start being more aware of the type of media that we're consuming. And the corporate media doesn't really, comfy and complacent, and they've been in those jobs for such a long time. There's no disruption, and they've gotten too comfortable. We need that disruption. I feel like if it takes screaming in their face, sometimes, you know, there are people who disagree with that method, but desperate times call for desperate measures, I think. I can't tell you how many times I've wanted to grab one of them by the ears and scream in their face that they're telling people the wrong information. And we're all supposed to just conform to whatever they say is, even when that information is blatantly wrong. And we can all as individuals look at each other and say, this is obviously not right. Why are we following this? There's almost like a forced conformity to this narrative, and we've got to do something. Otherwise, this is going to get to be a very serious problem if we allow it to continue like this.
I mean, in general, I definitely agree with you that it is, you know, an annoying tactic to just stand up and disrupt the meeting. But sometimes, you know, special circumstances call for special means, you know, and especially if you're telling the truth. I think that really matters the most. And also how you tell the truth. You know, sometimes we see activists take over school board meetings or take over some kind of meetings, and then they just blow their whistles and not let the other person be heard.
But I've seen some of those. Yeah, those are, I'm looking at it going, how are you even? The point is to get people to listen to you, you know, mm-hmm. and if you're just screaming nonsense. But the overwhelming amount of comments under this video that I posted was just so supportive of you and what you're doing, saying we need more of this. It's like, okay, you guys, let's do it together. Let's do more of this. Like, how do we do more of this? Everybody wants to do more of this.
Well, it's about telling the truth, I think. That's what makes it sets it apart. You know, why my video got so big, because it was translated into like other languages that I've seen.
I saw that too. I had people asking me for Spanish translations and all kinds of stuff. It was amazing. I was so blown away by this. That's why, like, I had to come find you.
Italian, German, Chinese, Russian. And then it got like 20 some million views on ByteDance, which is like China's version of TikTok, right?
Oh, wow.
Yeah, I know.
That's crazy.
It doesn't
crazy.
Surprise me. Yeah, 20 million views in China probably isn't a lot, because they have like 1.2, 1.3 billion people over there. So,
but that it made it that far, is just, it's crazy to see. I'm sure it's so surreal.
I mean, and like, I guess I would just emphasize to anybody who's thinking about doing this, you have to do it, especially if you know the truth is on your side. And I've had people ask me like, well, how do you know it's a right time to disrupt the meeting? It's how I think about my life, and also every interview I do, because it's all recorded history now. Who's going to be watching this 50 years from now, 100, 150, 120, 116 years, whatever, right? Sometime in the future, there's going to be people who are going to be watching what you and I are talking about and doing, and they're going to be either inspired by it, or they're going to be looking for something or some information out of it. And what I would want to tell the person watching this in the future is, like, because the circumstances are going to be different than what they are for us now, trust in yourself and trust in your instinct and your gut, and trust in the truth, you know, to tell you, like, okay, we're in a circumstance where somebody has to be a force for truth and represent the truth. You know, to the person whoever's watching this in the future or now, you know, there's an injustice, there's an abuse, and you will know if there's an injustice or an abuse happening. And as long as you take it from the highest standpoint and you speak from the standpoint of truth, be unafraid to stand up and say what's right, no matter who it is, but especially the evildoers. If you know you're going to confront somebody who's perpetuating the abuse and the injustice, definitely go after them and just stand up and speak the truth to them. And you see, you know, it resonates around the world, and it will resonate also throughout time, too. I'm a big believer that hopefully somebody will be inspired in the future when they see some kind of injustice, so that they can then stand up and do this, too.
It shatters that trust that you have in corporate media when you know that they've been wrong so many times and that they do bare minimum due diligence. I feel like the FTX situation was a big one, where we found out how little due diligence some of these companies do, not just the media, but hedge funds, big banks. I mean, Sam Bankman-Fried was on the Forbes cover. I mean, Taylor Swift dodged a bullet because she asked one question. Just bare minimum research, I think, is something that a lot of people are wanting to be more active with. And I definitely want to start broadcasting ways for people to be more effective at doing these things if there are places where people can go in person. And social media, I feel like, has been great for that because it allows people to stay home, and still broadcast these important. Without social media, we wouldn't be talking right now. You know, it can use your powers for good and not evil. Citizen journalism is so important right now. I feel like we've had our trust eroded in corporate media. I would much rather watch somebody's live stream of something happening than turn on the TV and watch whatever their version is, because you can't trust that, you know, second hand account of it anymore. It's been edited. It's been tweaked to sound and look a certain way, you know? So there's so many times where they've been caught with their pants down. People are just so tired of it. So,
yeah.
So that day, so what happened after they stopped you? So that's the next question everybody has. What happened after you got tackled? Tell us more about what happened. Did you get arrested? Did you get hurt? Are you?
No, okay? I didn't get arrested. I had a bruise on my knee from the tumble, but I actually did post the audio on my Twitter of what happened after. So Jelani Cobb, the dean of Columbia School of Journalism, of all people, was the one who tackled me down. And this guy is like a 6'5", like maybe 300-pound dude. And he's like grabbing me and bear hugging me, which now I see. Yeah, that term bear hugging apparently is a term of endearment. It did not feel like endearment.
It can be. I mean, bear hugging you is... If you bear hug somebody a little too aggressively on purpose, I did see some of that. I was wondering if that was a friendly hug or not, because no. I saw that there was a little bit of back and forth. He seemed very upset that you were there.
Yeah. So in the audio, I say to him, listen, you know, my heart's racing and it's hard to breathe enough already. Can you just let go of my chest? And I say, can you just let go here? He says, no, I don't trust you. And then I say, you're damn near choking me, man. And he says, I'm not choking you. Okay, I'm calm. And I say, okay, I'm calm too. And then he says, you're not going to come here and interrupt my event. And then I say, why not? He says, because it's my event. And then I say, oh, excuse me, more, Your Highness, my apologies. I didn't. Yeah. And so he finally lets me go once we're actually like downstairs from where the event took place. And that's what happened after. I just had to go. That's it. They don't arrest you. It's free speech, you know. They wouldn't try to arrest me in New York for speaking my mind. I didn't give them a reason to. It's not like I was violent or anything. And I'm just
surprised it was the dean and it wasn't secure, because it's kind of hard to see who it was. You know, all of a sudden we all love the Karen comment though. Get out of my face, Karen. Oh my God. That got me. A lot of people said that was their favorite line through the whole thing. Like, Karen, I need you to get out of my face. So we weren't really sure, you know, kind of how that played out. I'm surprised that staff would put hands on you instead of calling for security or.
I spoke to a contact of mine who's a former cop. I mean, the guy, it was the dean. It was also security, right? Because he had a Columbia patch on him. But he told me even then, security and the dean are not supposed to forcefully drag you out. They can ask you to leave. But if you say no, then they have to call for a cop to come in, like an actual cop to come in. So he said, like, I do have the right to press assault charges. But, I mean, you know, the damage has been done. I have no personal grievances with Jelani Cobb, except I know he's a staff writer for The New Yorker, so he's one of these stenographers also. But, you know, also I don't have money for a lawyer. There you go. Maybe I should leave with the real reason why. But, yeah.
No, be real with me always. I love it. This is so, I try to keep it casual. Everybody... You know, we're all tired of green screens and scripts and teleprompters. I feel like people are more looking to see more of this, like one-on-one information right from the source. What happened? How do you feel about it? Like what journalism was meant to be. All the muckrakers in the 1920s going and looking and seeing what's going on and actually giving, you know, talking to real people about what's happening. What's next for you? What are you doing after this? I know you've had so many interviews. What do you want? Where do you want to go from here?
Well, right now I've been telling people about this idea called the, you know, our government has been hijacked by tyrannical and fascist forces that have now plunged us into straight up fascism. You have people being censored, like Julian Assange or this Uhuru group that went to jail now. You have people like Tucker Carlson getting fired. And like, I'm not a big Tucker guy, but hey, the guy had on people like Glenn Greenwald, who were critical of the war, Aaron Mattei to talk about Syria. I mean, he had on dissenting voices of the popular mainstream narrative. And Tucker's been very clear that, you know, even he doesn't like working at Fox. I mean, and so he gets fired now. And then you have the Congress, which is completely bought and paid for. And I'll give you an example. I mean, there's a 26-year-old congressman named Maxwell Frost. He won his race down in Florida as a Democrat under the gun control platform, right? Because I think it was something like either somebody in his district or some school in his district was shot up, so he wanted to run on the ban gun law, you know, stop violence, right, in the community's platform. Okay, I don't care what anyone thinks about that, fine, whatever, you know, don't ask me to talk about the Second Amendment, but
that's a whole other episode.
But so that's supposedly what he ran on and what he won on, right, in Florida. Then Matt Gaetz introduces a bill called the Syria Resolution Bill. And the bill basically says, listen, you know, there's people dying in Syria from U.S. forces. 90% of them, of people in Syria, are living in straight up squalor and poverty because of our sanctions, right? And we never authorized Congress to be there. We shouldn't be there. So this bill tells the Congress to tell Biden to get our troops out. Maxwell Frost, who's part of the squad, voted to keep our troops in Syria, where there are documented cases of children dying by American troops and gunfire, okay? So no matter what you think about our involvement in Syria, this guy, 26 years old, votes to keep our troops in Syria. Is gun violence only okay when it's in other countries, right? Now, do I think this guy is evil and, you know, secretly wants, you know, other kids to die in other countries? No. He's just bought and paid for. He probably didn't even know what he was voting on. What am I voting on? Okay, is this yes or no? Yes? Okay.
I've noticed that too. That's a big thing that I like to do on my channel is they don't prepare before they make these big decisions. You know, they'll get, and it's not necessarily, there's a systemic problem where you have a bill that's 2,500 pages that gets dropped down in front of them and their staff like hours before they're supposed to vote on it. It's physically, even if they really wanted to read all of that, it's physically impossible with the amount of time they're given to prepare. And then to like really understand complicated legal, medical, financial implications for some of these bills. I mean, it is impossible to do it in that amount of time. And it ends up being voted on anyways, you know, that's a big part of the problem.
Yeah, we see that with the omnibus every year. Rand Paul makes a big deal about that every year. And it's worth making a big deal about it. And my other favorite one was Lindsey Graham. You know Lindsey Graham, right?
Yes. I know of him, yes.
So, you heard about this restrict bill, this restrict act?
Yes, yes. Okay. I did see that one popping up. I know that everybody's concerned that it's kind of the Patriot Act on steroids.
Yeah, right. Basically. So, Jesse Waters on Fox News did a great segment on it where he was going through how it's an invasion of privacy, it's unconstitutional, completely un-American. Nobody should support the Restrict Act. And then he cuts to Lindsey Graham, who's there live in the studio, is like, Senator, what is this bill, man? What's going on? And then Lindsey Graham says, well, I don't know what you're talking about. That bill, that is not American. That is unconstitutional. And then Jesse Waters says, you're a co-sponsor of this bill.
Oh my gosh, I need to go find that clip. That needs to make it. I have a whole playlist of called Trolling Politicians, where that's all it is. People that have pranked the hell out of some of these guys who they're obviously showing up unprepared, and you can catch them with their pants down, and it is so funny when it happens. I need to go find that clip. Oh my god. Yeah,
I'll send it to you after this. No, it was hilarious to see that. And so I see, you know, and Lindsey Graham's like, no, that can't be right, because that's the other bill you must be talking about. And he's like, I'm looking at congress.gov right now, Senator, and your name here is listed as a co-sponsor of this bill. But I guess it wouldn't be the first time legislators have other people make bills for them. Right, Senator?
Right?
Yeah.
Oh, my God. Mm-hmm.
It was good. It was a good clip. Yeah.
Yes, you need to send that to me. I'm adding that to my channel. So the big thing that has popped up a lot lately, not just your video, but the Julian Assange campaign, the Free Julian Assange campaign has popped up again, and we just had the Pentagon leak. So the points that you were making, that we have to find out the truth from all of these leaks, you know, it gives people some very strong mixed opinions on whether or not whistleblowers, you know, should end up in jail. I was always under the impression that there were protections for whistleblowers, but if you're whistleblowing on the government, I guess that goes away. Well, so are. I'm having a hard time understanding why Julian Assange is still even in jail right now.
There are protections for whistleblowers, but only if you blow the whistle on stuff they want you to blow the whistle on. You know, Edward Snowden and Julian Assange are being tried under the Espionage Act, but maybe that makes sense for Edward Snowden because he's an American citizen, but the Espionage Act is only enforceable on American citizens. Julian Assange is Australian.
Yeah. Okay.
So and the fact that he's being held in Belmarsh prison and has been for 4 years, where he has to defecate into a plastic bag. And, you know, if you want to visit him, you have to request a visit 6 months in advance. It's horrible what they're doing to Julian Assange. And,
I've never seen anything quite like it. It seems like he kind of stands alone in terms of, you know, journalistic prosecutions. Had the Pentagon whistleblower get arrested, and it seems like they've kept that relatively quiet.
Yeah, the military advisor for the New York Times said that, you know, because the New York Times and Bellingcat worked together to figure out the identity of the guy who leaked the documents, which was completely horrible and horrendous, right? That they were hunting down some 21-year-old kid who leaked it for whatever reason. He leaked it, right? On a Discord server.
A Minecraft Discord server. All the things. That is the stupidest thing I've ever seen. How does this happen? I personally don't understand how a 20-something-year-old kid even has the clearance to have access to documents like that. Never mind have the ability to, like, remove them from wherever he found them and dispense them publicly.
Which is why I've also been kind of, like, suspicious about what the actual leaks themselves contain and say and stuff. But, and, like, if this was all some kind of controlled leak or not. But regardless, we see that the New York Times was hunting down the whistleblower, whereas, you know, they were calling for protections of whistleblowers. And now here they're saying, well, this is different because this was a 21-year-old kid who was seeking for attention. And the military advisor said, had that kid come to us, the New York Times, with these documents, we would be protecting him right now, not, you know, trying to figure out who it was. And so, you know, this intelligence company, Bellingcat, they're a bunch of fucking rats and snitches that need to be, you know, and they get government funding for doing the work they do. And Bellingcop is the other nickname I give him. That's not mine. That's Aaron Mateus. But, you know, it was completely shameful that they went after this 21-year-old kid for just, you know, leaking these documents. And it just has bigger implications that the media is really not for you, you know. And I mean, they're going to go after anything you do and everything you do that challenges them. I remember when I went after AOC back in October, and that one went just as viral as the last one did. Took her 4 days to respond. But what did she say? Oh, you know, Jose Vega and Kynan Thistlethwaite are right-wing Trump supporters, cult members, and nobody should take anything they're saying seriously.
That's always the thing. I feel like we've gotten so polar with our politics where it's so easy to just, you know, brush everything to the side and say, well, that's woke or that's MAGA or that's a cult or that's, you know, it's easy to dismiss things as crazy. But I have people that will come to me when I have an idea that seems crazy. Hey, guys, I have this crazy idea. And everyone kind of blows it off. Give it 6 months. It seems like in the last few years, if an idea seems crazy, give it 6 months, because those are the ideas that end up being, you know, pretty accurate later on. And the fact that the media doesn't catch it when they're the professionals, you know, they're the ones that are supposed to be doing all of the due diligence behind everything that they, you know, it's not their responsibility to be suppressing things as they see fit when it suits them to suppress things. You know, it's important because when some of these stories influence elections, when they can influence public opinion of certain political figures, you see there's a lot of favoritism and what gets covered and what doesn't. And a lot of us are very, very tired of it. And so I think it's citizen journalism is important. And I think we need to continue to promote that, because it's the same without citizen journalism. I feel like most of what we know to be true now in terms of what's happening with the economy, in terms of what's happening with politics, the financial world on Wall Street, if not for citizen journalism, you know, there would be some very broken things that were swept under the rug that everyone really needs to know about just to be able to navigate the next few years and the chaos that's going to come with it.
Yes, I couldn't have said it better myself. It's true. And I give thanks to a lot of the independent media out there. Gray Zone is the biggest one that I think I get a lot of my sources from. And then whatever Glenn Greenwald is doing. Yeah.
What do you have coming up? Do you have any other events coming up that you're going to, you got anything else planned on your crash list?
Not that I have anything right now. These things usually come to me last minute.
That's exciting.
You know, which is better that way, because then, like, you know, if anybody's surveilling me or monitoring me, they can't know either. So
we'll have to, I don't want to take up a whole lot of your day. I know you've got other stuff planned, but I so appreciate you coming and talking with me about this. I definitely want to check in with you more again this time, because if you do this all the time, we want to talk to you all the time. We need more people that have balls. We need people that are going out there and actually saying these things and doing these things and putting boots on the ground. And I feel like there's a lot more to come, and I definitely want to check back in with you later.
Yeah, sure. No problem. Thank you. Anytime I do this again, I'll send it to you, and then you tell me if it's worth having me on for.
Yes, more episodes. Let's do it. I'm very excited. Okay. Yeah. Thank you so much for visiting with me, and I will talk to you again soon.
Always. Thank you.
Thanks.